Hey friends, welcome to this week's Moment with Miranda. I am so glad that you have chosen to take this moment today and to come into the Father's house, to come and sit at his table and to hear what he would say. Thank you for taking this moment to be one of his children in whom he finds great delight and just longs to know in an even greater way. So thank you for joining me today for this week's Moment with Miranda. This is a place where you and I get to believe what God says. This is a place where you and I get to speak what he says into the earth. And this is the place where you and I get to see the reality of it come to pass in our lives as we continue to believe it, to speak it, and to see it every day and every moment. So welcome today to this week's Moment with Miranda. I am so glad that you have chosen to take this time with me today. Today, I want to talk for a few moments about the thought of spoiler alert. Now, this week I was in Sunday school class at church. Yes, there are churches that still have Sunday school. My home church in particular has it, and I enjoy it because it's meaty. It's something that I can chew on and really meditate on. So this week I was in Sunday school class, and the teacher was talking about a story that I've read over many times, but of course there was something fresh that came to me through this time in class. And we were looking at the story that's found in the book of 2 Kings chapter 7. And it's where the nation of Israel is once again being attacked by these foreign invaders, and they're surrounded and they have become besieged in the city of Samaria. And it's bad. They've been there for weeks. They're starving. They're fighting one another. They're so hungry that they're eating donkeys' heads. They're eating doves' dung. They're eating one another's children because it has become so dire. I can't even imagine what that would have been like. And we see in this story that there were four lepers who were living outside of the city of Samaria, as any who had this type of disease would have been forced to do. I'm not sure that you and I can fully appreciate what it must have been like to be a leper during this time of life. You know, it was not just a sickness. It was an absolute shame. It was a disease that ate your flesh, that stunk. You were stripped of your personal dignity. You were outcast from society. Talk about being quarantined. You not only couldn't live in the city, you couldn't live in your own house. You couldn't be with your own family. Everywhere you walked, you had to yell, unclean, unclean, unclean. I mean, talk about being just emotionally wrecked and socially wrecked, let alone the religious affiliation that you would have been so happy to have been a part of as a believing Jew. You couldn't have a part of any of the sacrifices or any of the celebration or any of the religious community. It was being a complete and utter outcast. You know, it was a life of shame and of isolation, and it had to be condemnation because you never knew if you would ever become clean again. You were forced to live in that state. So here's these four men or women, actually we don't know, four lepers who were complete outcasts. And they were on the edge of the city. They were sitting right at the edge of the Syrian army who was there attacking the people of Israel. And they were starving to death, and they made this decision amongst themselves. They said, if we go into the city and if we find food, we're probably going to die. If we stay here, we're going to starve, so we're probably going to die. So we could go to the Syrian army and maybe they'll let us live and give us some food, or maybe we'll die. In any instance, they didn't have much of a choice. They just figured the odds are we're going to die, so we might as well do something. So as the story continues, we read where these lepers begin to travel down to where the Syrian army's tents are. And when they get there, they find that the tents have been totally abandoned of people, that there's no one there, because instead of seeing these four lepers coming into town, God caused the army to hear this sound of chariots. They heard the sound of these horses and this great great host coming toward them, and they went running for their lives. And I just think it's so cool that, isn't it just like our God, to use these people that were dirty, and they were marginalized, and they were outcast, and they were unclean in the eyes of man, and in the eyes of religion, in every way. And here God used them to send the enemy running spitless. You know, of course this is what he does. This is the God that we serve. He's the God that doesn't see us as we see ourselves or as others see us, but he sees us according to what he knows, and he delights in exchanging our shame for his glory. And so here we see these lepers, and they find the tents of the Syrians, and they are loaded with treasure. There's spoils and there's plunder, and they begin to go from tent to tent, and they're gathering food and gold and garments. And what I see in this story and in the symbolism of this is that they gathered food to satisfy their starving bodies, and they gathered these riches, which was the provision for the poverty that they had found themselves in. And then they were clothed in these garments. They were put back into a position, no longer naked and dirty, but they were accepted. And the Bible says that they would gather and they would hide, and they would gather more and they would hide. And then suddenly one of them says to the other, they say, guys, I could just hear it. This isn't right. This is a day of good news, and we cannot keep this to ourselves. We have to go and we have to share this with someone. And so they ran to the city and they told the gatekeeper everything that had happened and what they were experiencing, the spoils that had been left behind in an abundance just waiting for them to take advantage of. It was a true spoiler alert right there. And guess what? They didn't believe them. Imagine that. You know, it sounded too good to be true. It had to be a trick. They couldn't take a chance on that actually being the case, because what if it was really a deception of the Syrian army? And what if they were there just lying in wait to kill them? You know, why is it that human nature always tends to believe and agree with the negative more than we believe and agree with the fact that there's good news, that there is life? Why is it so hard for us to embrace the good? And what eventually happens in this story is the king sends out his servants, and the servants ask for 5 horses, but the king, I could just hear him saying, like, I'm going to take a chance on 2. So they send 2 horses out, a chariot, and they go, and they follow this trail, and they go from the city of Samaria to the Jordan River. It's like 20 miles. And all along that span of 20 miles, they just find vessels and garments and things left behind by the Syrian army. And the scripture says that it was exactly as these leprous men had said. And the people went and they spoiled the Syrians. They literally went and received the free gift that had been left there waiting for them. Friends, you know, today I have a spoiler alert for you. There is good news to be had and to be known for you, and I can't keep it to myself. It's so good that it's hard for me to keep my mouth shut about it anymore. You know, it has become a satisfaction to my hungry soul. It has become an immeasurable treasure, the riches of the glory of God that has just been shown to my life. It has removed the shame of my past and my nakedness, and has clothed me with the beauty of all that God says that I am. And everywhere that I go and everywhere that I look, I'm beginning to see the treasure of the kingdom that has been just left behind, these spoils that have been laid out, and it is free, and it is for whosoever will take it. Oh yeah, friends, you know what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I'm talking about the power of God unto salvation. I'm talking about the living word of God, Jesus. It's Christ, the wisdom of God, the power of God, the fullness of God, the life of God, the bread of God, the breath of God, the peace of God, the redemption of God, the satisfaction of God. It's Jesus. It's Christ with me. It's Christ in me. It's Christ for me. Friends, do you understand the depth of the good news that I'm sharing with you right now? This is the life. This is the spoil that God has given to us through Jesus Christ, the fullness of Him that filleth all in all, that fills your life and that fills my life. In the book of Colossians chapter 2, we read where Paul is pouring out his heart to this church, and he's warning them about the errors of believing that they have fallen into. And he says in verse 1, he says to them, I want you to know the great struggle that I'm engaged in for you. He said, and not just for you at that church, but also for the church at Laodicea and for others like you. And I think it's really interesting that in particular, Paul also mentions the church at Laodicea, because if you remember, this is one of the seven churches that Jesus calls out in the book of Revelation and he speaks to. And he says of this church that you're not hot and you're not cold, but you're lukewarm. And he says, you think that you're rich and you don't even know that you're poor. You don't know that you're naked, that you're blind, that you're outcast from my presence. He said, come and buy of me, literally buy out of me, that I'm it. Buy out of me gold and riches and garments, and I'll give you eyes to see. I'll heal your eyes. He says, please repent because I love you. What I hear in this prayer from Jesus, these words from Jesus, it was a rebuke, but it was a rebuke of love. And it was like, don't you know what you're missing here? It wasn't what's wrong with your head. You need to repent right now or you're going to hell. You know, that's not how I hear it right here. I hear, don't you know the spoils that are available to you? Don't you know me? Don't you know that I'm the one that you've been looking for this whole time? He says, repent. Come, buy of me, and I'll give you everything that you've been looking for. So I find it so interesting that Paul is writing to these believers as well, not just the Colossians, but also the Laodiceans, that lukewarm church. And he says, I want you to understand something, that I want you to understand what you have in Christ, all of the treasure and the wisdom and the knowledge of him. He's given that to you. All of the fullness of God is in him. He's the hope of your glory, and you are complete in him. And he says, don't let anyone rob you of the spoil of this truth. Don't let anybody spoil you of the reality of Christ. You know, friends, let me echo what Paul says. Don't let anybody take away from you or remove from you the simplicity and the bounty that is Jesus Christ. He's it. He's it. There's nothing more that you and I need. You know, to know him is eternal life. To know him is the life and the breath and the satisfaction of God. And we see that when God created you and I, that he created us in his image and in his likeness. And he created us to live in the light of his presence. I want us to understand that he created us to live fully exposed to his goodness and to his glory and to his face. To live in an open door to his house where we continually can come and sit at his presence and to know him. And he gave you and I, individuals, this personal value and this glory, but he clothed us with the glory of himself. We're just enrobed in the garden with the glory in the presence of God. And I don't know what that looked like, but they were naked and they were not ashamed. It was pure. And it was holy, and it was unveiled. It was full disclosure, and the Bible says it was good. God said it's good. You know, I think it's interesting that when he made man, he said it's good, but when he made woman, he said it is very good. I'll just leave that one there, right there. But here's the thing is that when man sinned, that glory that you and I were created to be clothed in, the glory that Adam and Eve shared, it was removed from them. It wasn't just about being cast out of a beautiful garden. It was about being removed from the presence of God and the glory that He had created and intended them to live and to move in and to have their being in was taken away. And suddenly there was this shame and this hiding because they realized that they were naked. And naked here doesn't just mean that they were without clothes. It means that they realized that they were helpless. That not only were they fully exposed, but it was this helpless state. And they were no longer able to live in the presence of this holy and just and magnificent and glorious and beautiful God because of their own state. In their own wretchedness. And the open door to His presence and to His house and to His table, to the garden of His goodness, was now closed to them. You see, friends, this is a spoiler alert right here. And it's not a good spoil. You know, it's the kind of spoiling that wasn't a free gift. It was the spoiling of us being stripped naked of everything that God had intended for us to live in. You and I need to realize the cost of the sin that we engaged in. Sin costs something. It costs so much, and it spoiled our lives. It plundered us of the glory of God. We were stripped of His image. We were stripped of His face toward us. We were stripped of the open door to His house and to His presence. And in that moment of sin, you and I became the spoils of the enemy's victory. We became captives to this enemy of sin and death and separation from the life and the presence of God. We were stripped of our intended purpose and sold into a life of bondage and slavery outside of the Father's house, away from the Father's presence, away from His goodness, all that we were intended for, living in this shame and living alone. And friends, you know, I'm not being over dramatic. This is the truth of our state without God. Without God, we are naked and we are nothing and we are without help and we bring nothing to the table. We're removed from His glory and from His presence. And friends, if I'm honest tonight, you know, I was just like those lepers outside the city of Samaria. You know, there was no place inside for my diseased nature. You know, I'm ashamed of the stench of my own self-effort. You know, I can't hide or cover up the open wounds or the scars of the past. My clothes are too ratty and they're too holy with holes. They're unwashed and I'm helpless and I'm cast out, and it makes me ashamed that I was like that, and I don't like it. I don't like to see my own inability. I don't like to see my own frailty. I don't like to see me because I'm proud. And I don't like to be exposed for who I really am in the face of the magnificence and the glory of a holy and just and righteous God. I don't like to see the state of myself. And I can only speak from the experience of my own life, that I was a lot like Adam and Eve. You know, I tried to use the fig leaves of my own self-effort to cover up, you know, my self-righteousness, my cloak of religion and religiosity, which I wore. You know, I truly did not know. You know, I thought that if I did enough, I could prove to God that I loved Him. I thought I could obey all of God's commands that he gave so that then I could be worthy of him using me for his glory. You know, it's embarrassing. Even to hear it just sounds, it makes me go, ugh. Like, I get sick to think of how I just didn't even realize that how much I was depending on my own performance to get me into the Father's presence, my own ability to do and to be right in order to one day be all that God said that I could be. I didn't realize, friends, hear me, I didn't realize that in Christ I already am all that God says and knows that I can be. I'm complete in him. When I'm in him, I start off in the fullness of himself. I start off being clothed in his righteousness. And I actually thought that the reason that I was so blessed and so good and just doing so wonderful was because I was doing it all right. And that I was in the perfect will of God. And that was all well and good for ministry. But what about for Miranda? What about the me beyond ministry? You know, we're not human doings. We're human beings. We were created to be. What about the peace that I never had with myself? What about the righteousness that was supposed to be mine? We hear these words. What about the joy that you and I are supposed to have as believers? And instead of receiving the good news of the gospel, I was trying to live the good news of the gospel. And no matter how hard I tried, I couldn't do enough. It wasn't so good. I mean, I hope that maybe some of you are resonating with this word that I'm sharing with you tonight. Maybe you can identify, because there was always something else for me to work on. I was ashamed because I would just keep pushing. If I kept pushing, eventually it would be enough. I would achieve that being all that I could be. If I would keep pushing, I could believe enough. If I could just keep pushing, I could prove enough. I would be enough. But I was never satisfied. And religion was never satisfied. And I never had enough. And I was never at peace in believing that I could come in full assurance into the Father's presence and ask what I would in faith, believing that I would receive and full of the joy of the Lord, like the Bible says that we can be. That's what the good news says that we can be. But friends, I was living like a leper outside of the kingdom of God. And I was living like those who refused to believe the good report that the enemy was gone. And there was this abundance of provision and life everywhere laid out before me because it sounded too good to be true. And it had to be a trap, and it had to be a deception. And I was living a life apart from the life of God because I had not truly received the free gift that Christ had given me, the spoils of the kingdom that he said was mine. I missed the best spoiler alert of all. We read it in Colossians chapter 2, verses 10 to 15. We read that we're complete in Christ, that we've been circumcised. We have been cut off from the desire to sin. We've been buried in his death. We've been raised in his life. We've been forgiven and totally free of the debt that we owed. He took it and he nailed it to his cross. And then he took his blood and he blotted out all of that handwriting of ordinances that was against us. And verse 15 says this. It says that he spoiled principalities and powers, and he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in what he did through the work of his cross. Spoiled here means that he completely disarmed and he stripped naked every principality and every power that thought that they had a right and an authority in our lives. He stripped them of that power and he displayed them openly as the spoils of his victory. He led them into shame and he led them into helplessness and said, "No more will my people be bound by shame and by helplessness, because they will walk in the spoils of my kingdom." He triumphed over them. And how did he do this, friends? He did this at great cost to himself. He embraced the shame of the cross for me, the shame of my self-effort. He embraced it and he took it as his own. I want you to follow this with me just here for a minute, because Jesus was clothed with the glory that he had with the Father from the beginning. He had a glory that God gave him, and he took that glory and he traded his robe of deity for the glory of humanity. He became like us and he put on this servant garb. He put on this veil of flesh. And then in his crucifixion and in that time leading up to his death, there were soldiers that put on their own garb on him. They put on a robe of a military man. They stripped him of his servant garb, and they put on this military garb and they began to mock him, saying, "Behold, the King of the Jews." And then these men stripped him of man's coat, their covering, and he became fully exposed on the cross. He became hung in the weakness of a man, and he was naked and he was helpless, and he became exposed to the shame of a cross, just like the shame that Adam and Eve experienced in the garden, just like the shame that we come to know whenever we see the reality and the gravity of our own sin. But I think that the greatest shame that Jesus experienced was not the shame of being hanging there naked in front of everybody to see, but I think that what must have been the worst was that the realization that he was now naked of the glory of his Father, that he was now abandoned from the presence of his Father, because in that moment on the cross, he didn't say, "My Father, why have you forsaken me?" He said, my God, why have you forsaken me?" It was a realization that he wasn't in the Father's presence anymore, that he was in front of the holy God who had a price for sin, and it was high, and it was costly, and he was no longer in the presence of his Father because of our sin, because of what we did. Friends, in that moment, he embraced our shame and every sin and every pride, every unbelief and every filth and every evil thought. He became our sin. And the next robe that he took on in that moment was the robe of death, the clothes of a dead man. And they laid him in the grave. And Satan thought that he had spoiled God's plan. But as Jesus' earthly body lay in the grave, he was doing his work. His blood was spoiling the enemy. He was securing our victory and restoring our glory. This amazes me. In the garden, when Mary saw him in his resurrected form, you know, how did she see him first? First, she thought he was a gardener. She saw him in the garb of a gardener. You know, he looked just like a husbandman. Imagine, God was a gardener in the Garden of Eden, was he not, back at the beginning? She saw him as the husbandman, but then she saw him in his glory, the gardener in his glory. And this is what's so cool, is that on the day of Pentecost, when men and women were gathered together, and they were in this upper room, and they were ready to receive the spoils of Christ's victory, they were about to be enrobed, to be clothed with power from on high, and the glory of God would once again fall upon men whom he had redeemed back to his image and back to his likeness, and we would once again be enrobed in his glory. It's a spoiler alert, friends. This is the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. This is the power of God to salvation for any who would believe. And you and I cannot afford to keep the spoils of this good news to ourselves anymore. Maybe tonight you think that sounds too good to be true. It is too good to be true. It's amazing. It's too good. It's so good. It's riches and it's food and it's sustenance and it's life and it's restored position for all of humanity, for whosoever will, that will come and receive. It's the treasure of the fullness of God given to mortal man to make us more than we could ever be on our own. It's this humanity clothed in royal deity and glory and honor. It's amazing. It's an amazing truth that if you and I could capture the reality of the fullness of God, the spoils of the victory of Christ that he has left, we will be so endued and enabled and empowered to walk forward in the might and the anointing of the Holy Spirit that we're called to walk in these days. Friends, if the gospel that you and I are believing does not give you life, does not give you breath, does not give you hope, does not endue you with power, does not give you the riches of his glory and of his purpose, then I have to ask you, are you believing the gospel of Jesus Christ? Are you believing the good news that you're restored, that we're restored? Friends, this is the truth. This is the truth. In this moment today, this is how you and I are called to live. Empowered by living in the presence of God. He has been fully satisfied by the work of Jesus on the Christ. Jesus took my shame so that I could take on his glory. So that I could walk in the glory of his new nature, that I could walk as he is in this world. The Bible says, as he is, so are we in this earth. You are no longer a leper. You are no longer an outcast. I am no longer bound to the treadmill of my performance in order to be, because God has made me one with himself through Christ, and he has told me all that I am. I've been made near by the blood of the Lamb, and he has given me access to his presence and access to his face and access to his house so that I can boldly approach the throne of grace, so that I can boldly take of the spoils of the kingdom of God. We live in the glory of this kingdom. This is the kingdom of God. This is the goodness of God. Spoiler alert, friends. The spoils of the victory of Christ are ours. They're ours. They're ours for the taking. And now is the time, friends, that we cannot keep this good news to ourselves. we get to live in the presence of a delighted Father. And as children of this delighted Father God, we can go forth into the world and to bear His image to the world and to carry His light and to take back those whom the enemy has taken captive at His will, to take the spoils from the enemy and say, no, they are the spoils intended for the kingdom of God. Because He has caused us to triumph through the work of Christ. It's time, friends. It's time for you and I. It's time to live in the spoils of the kingdom and to go out and spoil the kingdom of the enemy for the kingdom of Christ and for God. Let's pray today. Heavenly Father, thank You. I thank You so much for this moment to recognize the spoils that You have just lavished upon Your sons and Your daughters. We no longer have to live as lepers. We no longer have to live outside the city of God, hoping, taking a chance that maybe we live, maybe we die. We no longer have to live apart from Your touch and apart from Your presence, because Christ has redeemed us through His precious blood. He took back what the enemy tried to steal, and He has spoiled the works of the enemy, and He has made us a triumph unto Himself through His work. And Father, I ask that in this moment that we would live in the reality of this, the glory of the good news of the kingdom of God, that we're no longer slaves to fear, that we're no longer slaves to shame, but we live unveiled and fully clothed with the glory of God. I thank You, Father. Thank You for boldness to go forth and to share this good news of the kingdom of God, that Christ has come and reconciled God to man. Thank You for Your amazing work. In Jesus' name, amen. Wow, friends, this is so awesome. We live in the spoils of the kingdom of God. And I thank you so much for joining me today for this moment with Miranda. This is a moment where I'm going to believe it, and I'm going to speak it, and I'm going to see it in my life, because it is too good to not be true. It is the good news of the gospel. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. And you know what, friends? He loves us. He loves us. He loves us. He loves us. And I love you too. I hope that you will join me again next time for another Moment with Miranda. God bless you guys.